As a small, mostly unheard of independent record label, based not in New York or Los Angeles, but in Jackson, Mississippi, Malaco Records has managed to outlast major record label competitors like Motown, Stax, and Chess Records. Referred to as the last soul company, it's been home to multiple recording artists and songwriters and has a catalog of original recordings and music copyrights numbering into the thousands. NewsHour Weekend's Christopher Booker brings us the unlikely and long-lasting story of Malaco Records.
From soul to blues to gospel, Jackson, Mississippi's Malaco Music Group has seen and done it all. Now, after over 50 years, the story of one of America's oldest surviving independent music companies is being told.
Do you think the general population, the general music fan, knows of, and by extension, appreciates Malaco's contribution?
No, absolutely not.
Rob Bowman is the author of The Last Soul Company, The Malaco Record Story.
Mainstream America doesn't have a clue what Malaco is. But for older black soul blues fans, Malaco's associated with an incredible run.
This run started in the 1960s. Tommy Couch was one of the founders.
In the early stages, we would try to make a record like a lot of other independent producers and studios. And we would rush to New York or LA or somewhere and try to lease it to a major. We could get nobody interested, so we had to put these records out ourselves.
Malaco's early days were lean, but early in the 1970s, their studio recorded two big songs. King Floyd's Groove Me, released on Malaco's Chimneyville label, and Gene Knight's Mr. Big Stuff, released by nearby Stax Records. Rather unbelievably, given Malaco's longevity, the company and their labels never produced a number one radio hit in the pop music world. Only three of their songs cracked the top 50. The last one came from Dorothy Moore in 1976.
Look like I kept you off of my mind.
But year after year, Malaco has survived, even as so many others shut their doors.
Everything's Motown, Chess, Atlantic, Stax. Glorious labels, every one of them. And, you know, many more hit records than Malaco. But none of them survived as long. They all ceased to be living entities, and they all stopped being independent. Malaco has been independent 52 years straight.
Integral to their survival has been an ability to adapt. While it may have started with a quest for hits on the pop charts, this is not where the label ended up. Their move to a genre known as soul blues, and more importantly, gospel, is why Malaco is still here. But you see, I come to tell you. In the world of gospel music, there is nothing larger than Malaco, whether through their own recordings or acquisitions. In 1986, they acquired the Savoy catalog, making Malaco the largest gospel label in the world.
When you think about the black church, you got to think about the music of the black church. And we're right at the top of that list when you look at the music. I mean, Reverend James Cleveland, Mahalia Jackson. So there's a lot of history throughout the years that, you know, we have, and we're very proud of.
Malaco has blown the roof off gospel sales a few times. Mississippi Mass Choir's first album may have been the largest selling gospel album in history.
Released in 1989, the Mississippi Mass Choir's debut album became the number one spiritual album in the country and spent 45 weeks on the Billboard charts. But like every other corner of the music industry, the market for gospel music has changed. Much of Malaco's business is now conducted online and through the streaming platforms. Malaco has in recent years been digitizing and uploading all of their recordings.
From the most obscure track that sold virtually nothing whenever it was released. And the idea was, even if it generated $20 in streaming royalties in a year, you multiply that by tens of thousands of tracks, you can survive.
This archive created another benefit. It's increased the number of licenses and sampling deals for Malaco. In recent years, their recordings have been sampled on songs by Kanye West, Drake, DJ Khaled, Snoop Dogg, and Cardi B. But Malaco's been sampled for years, starting where so much of hip-hop started, with Grandmaster Flash.
And they sued to get paid on that. But Grandmaster Flash recorded a song that he called Freedom, and actually, ironically, sampled a song by a Malaco group called Freedom.
Yeah.
And of course, that was back in the Wild West days of sampling in the early 80s, where nobody cleared anything. And if you got sued, maybe you paid something. And Malaco was right on top of it, sued. I don't know what they got paid. Obviously, that's confidential. But that was the first sample. Later on, people like Celine Dion sampled Reverend James Cleveland songs. Pusha T has sampled Malaco stuff. And one of the really great ones was Shaggy. Bombastic, one of the biggest hits of the 90s. And he's sampling a King Floyd song, Baby Let Me Miss Kiss You. Sookin' now, look at that. Baby,
let me do it till you let me kiss you, baby. What do you think the story of Malaco and its longevity says about the music industry?
Well, it says the music industry is much like capitalism in general. There are multi-levels, multi-tiers at which one can play the game. It operates the way companies operated 40, 50, 60 years ago, and I'm talking about small companies. But it's not like they're these old geezers who don't know what's going on. They're incredibly smart and have adapted to the industry, but they've never sold to anybody. They've been completely independent. They have nobody's expectations except their own.